also appreciate those who join us on LifeGate Outreach TV or those who will listen to this on audio message after now. The Lord's grace and mercies will reach you right where you are every time you listen. In the mighty name of Jesus. We are grateful to God for the privilege He's given to us to be on this journey of developing the kingdom character. This year's theme has been so powerful in God reminding us that we are kingdom citizens, and not only are we kingdom citizens, we are entitled to the treasures of the heavenly kingdom that we belong. And so we are so grateful that He is reminding us of the character that is expected of every one of us as the citizens of this kingdom. And so I want to just encourage you this morning to continue to meditate on these words so that the Lord Himself will continue to honor His word in your life in the name of Jesus. We have been looking at different kingdom characters, particularly as they relate to us as a church in terms of our five core values. And we started with our core value of love 2 weeks ago, and then we talked about the core value of ability last week, which is using our God-given abilities to serve God even as He has commanded. Today we are looking at the kingdom value of faith, which God gave to us, is our third core value as a church mission. And that core value just simply says we will always act in faith as God instructs us. Now, this is very important for us, not only as a congregation, but also as individuals and as families and as a people called to serve the Lord. We have a banner today which I had just prepared from a picture of a child, because my emphasis today is to look at childlike faith as a prerequisite or as a requirement for us to be able to walk in faith. So the title of today's message is The Kingdom Character of Faith. And that picture just shows a man who rightly should be the father of that child, or could be the father of that child, and a child who is leaping from a higher ground into the arms of this person. I want to say that this is the picture of how God wants us to be in terms of our faith in Him. He wants us to be a people who, like this child, would leap with confidence and will not mind the fact that we are committing ourselves completely into the hands of our Father. We all know that as children growing up, many of us were privileged to have fathers that we could easily rely on like this. Or even if they were not your biological father, you had adults around you who carried you, people who would throw you up, and you were not afraid that they were going to catch you and they wouldn't let you fall to the ground. And this is how God wants us to live our lives as a people who have this childlike faith. The Bible makes us to know that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And many times we limit this to only the things that are physical and material. So we say we have faith to buy something. We have faith to marry. We have faith to buy a house, buy a car, buy clothes, and do those things. Faith to do things that are material, faith to get a job, whatever kind of thing like that. But I want you to know today that the things that we hope for as Christians are much more than those material and those earthly things. We are hoping for the coming of a king, our king, Jesus Christ. And our biggest faith must always be rooted in that. That's why the Bible says, let us continue to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Because that is the eternal reward that we get. We receive Him into our lives and we continue to look up to Him so that we can live lives that are worthy and lives that will enable us to have the permanent assurance of physically living with Him after the end of time. I pray that our faith will continually be kindled in this way. In the name of Jesus. But on that journey to that eternal hope that we have, we must always be like young children who are always committing ourselves into the hands of the Almighty God in confidence and assurance at all times. Every time He commands us to do something, every time He requires us to do something, we must be committed to living our lives into the hands of the one who is able to protect it. Without that kind of faith, the Bible says it is impossible to please God. Without a faith that is completely reliant, dependent, totally yielded to the commandments of God, the Bible says it is impossible to please God. And this is why I want us to quickly look at it. Everyone who we read about in scriptures, we read the whole of Hebrews chapter 11 intentionally today during our scripture reading to remind us of all those people: Abraham, Joseph, Isaac, Jacob, Esau, all the people that the patriarchs, and a lot of other people, Samson, Barak, read about Rahab, we read about David, Samuel. All these people that we talk about had elements of their lives that qualified them for faith because they were childlike in their faith. Not childlike in disposition or in maturity, but they were childlike as far as faith was concerned. So Hebrews 11:1, the very first verse where we read today, said, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." Verse 2, let's read verse 2 together. "For by it," that is faith, "the elders obtained a" what? "A good testimony." Tell your neighbor for me, you will obtain a good testimony. You only need to have faith. Go straight to verse 6. It says, "But without faith it is impossible." Not partially possible, not likely possible. It is impossible. It just cannot happen. If you and I are people that live without faith, I want you to know that it becomes impossible to please Him. For everyone who comes to God must believe in two things. One, that He is, He exists. And secondly, that He is a rewarder. Now, I have never, in my short journey of life so far, I have never met a believer or a Christian that would say to me physically that I don't believe God exists. That is a phrase you will hear from atheists and people who say they don't believe God exists. Every believer, in quote, will always tell you, "I believe." But how do you know that you truly believe, or how do other people know that you believe? It's in the disposition that you yield to in the face of life's troubles and challenges that come your way. How you handle situations, how you respond to the word of God, how you believe the word for the different things that God has promised you, believing that He is able to deliver you, and in a time of trouble, you still can call on Him, shows that you truly believe that He is. But if in the time of trouble and in the day of persecution and in the day of trial, you are not believing or you are exhibiting other traits, then it simply means you are not believing as you ought to believe. So my charge to you today, that the Lord Himself will help you to truly believe that He is. I said the Lord will help you to believe that He is. And then He will help you to also believe that He is a rewarder of you because you diligently seek Him. So shall it be your portion. When you have these two things set, a lot of things that people chase about and people worry about in life will no longer be able to control you and give you the same effect that others have. In the midst of trouble, you believe that He is. Everybody else is shouting, panicking, worried. You are stable because you believe that He is. You will not be like those ones on the boat who, despite the fact that He is there with them physically, they were shocked. They said, "Don't you care if we perish?" If they believed that He was truly their Savior, whom they followed, they would not ask such questions, because they would know that He's there and His presence is enough to secure their release. Hallelujah. And that you believe that He is your rewarder you will not be moved by what you see as you diligently seek him. A lot of believers do not know today that God is their rewarder. This is why we have, as I always say, we have wishy-washy Christians in the body of Christ today, because many people think that their rewards come from man. Many people think that their reward comes from a system. Your job is just an avenue of God to put some aspects of income into your life. A fraction of what you need to earn in life comes from your job or your business or whatever you do for a living. God is your rewarder. Somebody say to your neighbor for me, God is your source. God is your source. He will remain your source. He will remain your rewarder. In the name of Jesus. When you are settled in these things, your faith life is very different. You serve God with a passion. When you know that reward comes with diligent service. Nobody will tell you to be diligent with service, because you understand that what makes for reward to happen is in diligent service. Hallelujah. As long as your focus on Jesus, whom you serve, is never broken, there is nothing that any man can do on earth to discourage you in your place of service. Hallelujah. What the devil likes to do to believers is to get us to take that focus away from Jesus and keep seeing one another and keep looking at things that are physical, things that you can see. And when your focus is shifted there, you are drifted between opinions and thoughts and people's praises and people's curses and people's abuse and people's reward and people's encouragement and people's discouragement. So it pulls you up and down and sideways, forward, backward. Every time you find it difficult to make proper motion spiritually, because your focus is broken. How many people know how difficult it will be if you are driving and you are trying to read every billboard and you are trying to see the color of every car that goes past you? It's just a matter of time. I can tell you what will happen to such a driver. It's obvious. If you are driving, you keep your focus on your track. In your mind, you have a picture of where you are going. How many people understand what I'm talking about? When you came to church today, as many of you that drove here, in your mind, in your subconscious mind, you had a picture of this church location, and from wherever you were, you took all the routes that can get you there, but your mind was because you had a destination that you are going. You, as a believer, must consistently remember that there is a diligent God who has every reward in his hand, but he is asking you to keep your focus on him. And may that your focus never be broken. In the name of Jesus. So our faith is the evidence of the reality of God that we have in our lives. By faith, we started this journey, as we remind ourselves again in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. Everybody becomes a believer by faith. You heard that again in the course of the charge this morning. Ephesians 2, 8, the Bible says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that is not of yourselves, but it is what? A gift of God." So faith brought you to the journey of salvation, and faith must continue to keep you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Just giving some background scriptures to help us on in this message. 2 Corinthians 5, 7. Let's read it together. "For we walk by faith, not by sight." Read it again. "For we walk by faith, not by sight." Now, why was Paul making this emphasis? The easiest thing to do in life is to walk by sight. It doesn't cost anything to walk by sight. You just simply need to open your eyes and let your feelings loose. Then you walk by sight. Then you are moved by the things you feel. You are moved by the things you can see. You are moved by the things you can hear. But the difference that is enumerating here is that we must learn to walk by faith. How do you walk by faith? Simply walking as commanded by God, believing only what God says, acting on only what God says, not allowing the physical circumstances of your life per time to dictate your life or command your life, but rather letting the word of God dominate your life. For example, if you are a married couple And the Bible says two are better than one. And what you can see in the physical, in your marriage, the first year, the second year, the third year, and for many years, doesn't look like better as far as you are concerned. You continue to believe God for the word that is supreme. The Bible says two are better than one. And God cannot lie. So you stand on that word. You don't stay on what you can see in the physical. If you have a child that is at the present time not appearing to want to do the things of God, the Bible says you and the sons that the Lord has given to you, you are for signs and wonders in Israel. And so you are for signs and wonders, and what you are seeing now about this child doesn't look like sign and wonder. Just looks like trouble and trouble and more trouble. But you don't keep confessing that trouble. You confess the sign and wonder, and whatever wisdom God gives to you to relate with that child so that the sign and wonder that God has made him will manifest is what you continue to walk by. This is how we walk by faith. And may the Lord continue to help us to walk by faith in the name of Jesus. So our faith in God is constant, and it should be constant, and it must be evidenced by the way we proclaim, the things we say, and also how we pray. Mark 11:22-24. Jesus answered and said to them, "Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, 'Be removed and cast into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Many of us read this scripture, but we do not understand the power in it. Let's read verse 24 again. It's on the screen. "Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Look at your neighbor and tell them. I say, "Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." It changes your prayer life. It modifies your faith life. It transforms your supernatural abilities. The more of this scripture and scriptures like this that you can believe. That is why the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. These are scriptures that should help you to have a transformed way of thinking, a transformed way of reasoning, a transformed prayer life. It saves you hours and hours. Now, I'm not against of long time prayer because it is all acceptable. But there is no point praying for 3 hours, 4 hours, without believing in your heart that when you are praying, you are not believing that you will receive. Faith must be that you are praying and you are believing that you are receiving at the same time. The two things come together before you have whatsoever you say. The body of Christ today is not enjoying the benefits and rewards of prayer because many times we don't believe what we pray. How do we know we don't believe what we pray? When we pray and we act contrary to the things we pray, then we didn't believe what we prayed. When you pray, you must believe that you are receiving and you will continue to have everything that you believe. And I'm going to tell you, there are some things that you really need to believe and it happens immediately. There are some things that you believe, but they happen after some time. But you must never let go of your faith. You must never let go of your belief because God is the one that makes all things beautiful in his time. There are certain things you are asking for right now, but God, who in his infinite mercies understands that you don't need them right now, will make sure that they don't get to you right now. And he will make everything that you need right now get to you. And when that thing now manifests later on, you understand. And then you appreciate why God has kept it for this long. I pray that God will continue to honor your prayer that you make in faith in the name of Jesus. Faith, therefore, thrives when it is childlike. When we have faith in a way that we are like children, we get the rewards of it. Look at what Jesus said in Luke chapter 18, verse 15. Luke chapter 18 from verse 15, the Bible says, "Then they also brought infants to him, that he might touch them. But when the disciples saw it, they rebuked him. But Jesus called them to him and said, 'Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it.'" I want you to understand that this is what God desires for you and I. We must receive the kingdom of God as little children. When we talked about the heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, I won't read it again. Every one of these people, if you take their lives and see their points of faith and confidence in God, they were childlike. They just simply did things that were looking ridiculous, like children will do. How can you tell me of a man like Joshua, who they're trying to fight a city that is fortified with walls that can take six chariots at a time going on top of them? How can you tell me that it is ordinary to just believe that all he needed to do was to go around the city once for 6 days and on the seventh day go around it for seven times? How can you say that is all he needed to do and then that was going to be victory? That was the faith of a child. Just simply believing that if God said it is so, so shall it be. There are many people who in our day and age are no longer childlike in the faith simply because we think that we have known more than that is actually working against us. And what we need to do is to go back to that place where we believe God as little children. The devil will continue to contest with your childlike faith because he knows the power in it. But you and I must continually walk against those things that the devil will want to use to keep us not believing God for who he is, just as little children. And may the Lord continue to help us in the mighty name of Jesus. I want to quickly share with us some characteristics of childlike faith. Some things that we can easily see from children and their lifestyles that will help us to reflect on where we are with those kind of attributes in our lives. The first thing is confidence. Somebody say confidence. Say confidence. Confidence. Children are very confident in their parents. They are very confident in adults and the people who are meant to be taking care of them. When you look at a child, you can learn a lot that the way they put their trust and confidence in the people who God has put to take care of them is amazing. And we must understand that this is how God wants us to be. Paul the Apostle was a person who was very confident. After he got salvation in Acts chapter 9, we saw that Paul became very radical for Jesus. He was very confident. He was bold and audacious. He was not afraid. He was not intimidated by what people felt anymore. How many of you know or can remember when you used to play in the playground and you had some other children who were around you and who were having bullish tendencies because they're bigger than the other kids and they tend to want to dominate. And you had these children who at times they just take over a little portion of the playground. I've experienced such as a child, I remember very well. But you know, you always have a confidence that if your mom or your dad was anywhere nearby, if those chaps tried anything, you knew that there was always somebody that could protect you. How many people remember what I'm saying? Yeah? You remember that? So you had no worries at all because you know that it's just a matter of time. If this guy doesn't allow me on this slide this time, I'm going to tell Papa. And I know that when Papa appears, this guy will melt away. Hallelujah. And I want you to know that the same way we have that confidence in our parents as children, this is how we need to have the confidence. God wants us to be confident in him. We don't need to be afraid of the things the enemy is throwing at us if we have the genuine, sincere confidence in God. We don't need to be ashamed of the gospel that we have received. Paul said in Romans 1:16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes." Hallelujah. It is the your power of God unto salvation, and you must not be afraid of it. Our believer generation are ashamed of the gospel in many ways. Many of us cannot confidently talk about our God to other people, particularly people who we feel may make a mockery of our lifestyle as Christians. Many of us are scared to talk about the Jesus that we say has saved our lives. We must remember that the confidence that we have in him, the Bible says, Jesus said, "Anyone that denies me before men, I will deny before my Father." We must understand that how we are able to receive the full grace and measures of God is to keep presenting him boldly, confidently. When your faith life is like that, it is activated. Your prayer life becomes shorter, more effective, more effectual. Because God sees you as a person who is not ashamed of him. And so everywhere you are, like Paul, every time they tried to kill Paul, God rose up miraculously for him. There were many times they left him for dead, but he refused to die before his time, simply because his confidence in God was radiant. You and I must come to that place where we are always confident in God. We are never allowing the situations of life and the people who are trying to make a mockery of our faith to be intimidating unto us. We are wondering why our faith is not strong. But if we can come back to these places where we can boldly talk about our God, where we can boldly say that we are children of God, we are Christians, we believe in Jesus Christ, that does not mean that we do not respect and respect other people's beliefs. It doesn't mean so. It simply means that we know what we believe and we stand on what we believe. And the Bible says we believe, therefore we also speak in 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 13. We believe, therefore we speak. So we must always express our confidence. This is how we live by faith. This is how we express that in our faith walk, we are truly confident on who. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 35, the Bible says, "Therefore, do not cast away your confidence." Don't cast it away. You had it at the beginning. You came very, very joyfully, cheerfully, confidently. You came to God. And then you started walking in that confidence. But then suddenly you started to become a mature Christian. A mature Christian should be more confident about God, not less confident. A mature Christian should be more vociferous about God, willing to talk more about him, not now having this mentality that says I need to be politically correct in a way. A mature Christian is one that should teach others how to be confident about God. The Bible says don't cast it away, because there is always a potential to cast away your confidence. If you want your faith life to be strong and solid, your confidence in God must be strong and solid at all times. Don't cast it away, because it has great reward. Hallelujah. Number two thing is that children are very transparent. Transparency of children, with children, what you see is what you get. Children have no ability. I'm talking about very young children, and I know that these days the age is really going down, down, down. When I talk about these kind of things, you need to be mindful. A 10-year-old about 20 years ago is no longer like a 10-year-old now. It's very different. A 10-year-old now is not like what it used to be 20 years ago. Probably about 6. What a 10-year-old now? 4. Yeah, very true. What a 10-year-old used to know and could do 20 years ago is probably what a 4-year-old would confidently handle now. Somebody was showing me a 2-year-old yesterday who was just doing that on a tablet, and she knew exactly what she was doing. 2 years, she was just turning 2. Actually, yesterday was her second birthday, and the girl could navigate her way around a tablet that was given to her. That is how much, that is why it's very, very soon we'll be talking about, when we say children, we might as well say infants. But if you look at very young children, you look at these children that are 2 years, thereabouts, 3 years, they don't have a way to hide emotions. If they are sad, you can see very easily that they are sad. If they are happy, you can see that they are jolly and they are happy. Why? That is very important. We must not mask our emotions before God. We must not mask our situations before God. Every one of us must realize that we are under, God understands that we are in the flesh, and there are times that we are tormented. There are times that we are confused. There are times that we are under pressure. There are times that we are physically tired. We do not need to mask anything. We just need to go before God and receive strength. The centurion man that we talk about from time to time was a man who went to Jesus Christ and was looking for a solution for his servant to be healed. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 8, he said, the centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof. Only speak a word and my servant will be healed. Verse 10, the Bible says, when Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. These were Jesus' words to a man who simply said, I so have confidence in you, my paraphrase now, that all you need to do is to speak a word. All you need to do is to speak a word. I am so confident that if you speak that word, my servant will be healed. And Jesus was virtually wowed that I have never seen such great faith, not even in Israel. And verse 13, he now said to him, go your way. Jesus said to the centurion, go your way. And as you have believed, let it be done for you. And his servant was what? Healed that same hour. How many of us know that the more we can come to God in confidence and transparently showing that we believe that even though we are frail in what we are, but he is able to help us. How many of us know that we will continue to receive God's help? I say you will receive God's help. In the name of Jesus. Those of you who are studying, young people, don't hide your limitations from God. And as he gives you wisdom to meet people, to help you through your schoolwork, don't feel any element of pride in asking those that could help. Let the Holy Spirit minister to you. Let him teach you. Let him direct you to places you should go, to resources you should use, so that you continue to let God work for you. Your faith will be strong when you allow the transparency of a child to manifest in your life. When you allow the what you see is what you get kind of attitude, that this is just who I am at this point in time. I am looking unto Jesus for perfection, but this is who I am. And this works in every aspect of life. Don't struggle with anything that the devil is using to limit your faith and affect your spirituality. You need to keep opening them up to God. Go before God. He knows them, but he wants you to talk about them. That's why he said, when you pray, because he wants you to pray. He wants you to talk to him about those things. And as you confidently do so, the Lord will continue to reach out to you. By faith, you will continually be delivered. In the name of Jesus. Thirdly, children are stressless. Children have no concern, no care whatsoever about the things that are happening in the future. Young children will not come to you and start asking you about what is happening in America. I mean, very young children now. What is happening in America? What is happening to Brexit? What is happening to the war in Syria or Iraq or Afghanistan or those places? They don't worry about a bank account. They are so confident. They don't worry about the price of bread or of petrol. It means nothing to them. As far as children are concerned, those things are a given. They should just be. How many of you have seen young people in the house that just simply ask for things? Because they don't, it's not their concern about how those things get there. And this is how God wants us to be with him. We as children of God should not be concerned about how God meets our needs. The reason why our prayers are ineffective and we are stressed in life is because we are asking God for things, but at the same time, we are reasoning with God how he will do them. It doesn't work that way. Have you ever seen your child come ask you, Dad, I want to go on this school trip and it's going to cost X let's say, £50, something. You know, we're going to somewhere and we need to pay £50. And he brings the form for the payment of the trip. Now, does your child stay after that and say, "Dad, how are you going to get this money now? Are you going to work extra? Are you going to get something? Do you have money in account A or account B? How is that what your child will do with you?" No. He or she will dump the form on you and say, "We need to take it in by Friday." Isn't it? That's it. And as far as he's concerned, Dad always either writes a check or puts something in an envelope and fills the form. And Friday, he takes it. Doesn't care, give a care whatsoever about how Dad gets the money. Because that is not his responsibility or her responsibility. We must be people, when we go to God, are also like children who have a confidence that when we go to God, we don't need to reason out how he's going to meet our needs. I live my life like this. I've lived my life like this for years. When my wife and I married, when we got married over 21 years ago now by God's grace, we discovered that before we even got married, when we met about 25 years ago, we discovered that there is no way, we thank God we had understanding that we needed to rely on God for everything, but we even physically saw that we didn't even have a choice. It was not just about having faith because we understood from the word of God that we should have faith. We saw that there was nobody on either side of our families that we could even say was the big man. Everybody around us that time had a big man in the family. They either had a big uncle somewhere, a big father somewhere, somebody somewhere. We looked, I said, you and me, nobody even has anybody that we can say. And from that time we learned that it is better for us to be looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And we live stresslessly because of that. I don't stress myself. If I need £100,000 tomorrow, I am so settled in God that if I don't have it in my bank account, if it is truly a need for tomorrow, it will happen by tomorrow. You don't believe that? If you like, believe it. If you like, don't believe it. I know I believe it and it works for me. If you truly believe God like this centurion, you will live stresslessly. You will live a transparent life. You will be able to say, "Lord, I just believe your word for what it is." And God will meet you at the point of your need. John the Baptist initially was very stressless. In Matthew chapter 3, the Bible says, verse 1, "In those days, John the Baptist was preaching in the wilderness, and he was saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.' For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, 'The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.'" Verse 4. Now, let's read that, verse 4. "Now, John himself was" what? "Clothed in" what? "Camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was" what? "Locusts and wild honey." Somebody says stressless life. He was the biggest evangelist in town. In our day and age, some people would have asked him that, "Why don't you have protocol? You should have detail. You should have a lot of people who are working for you. You should have, you know, you can't be dressed like this. How can you be wearing a leather belt and a camel's hair? Which kind of clothes is that? You should be in fur and these kind of heavy robes that were costly at those times." The Bible says he was there clothed in camel's hair, leather belt. His food was locusts and wild honey. And his ministry was going on. What am I trying to say? When you are a child, when you are a person with childlike faith, you live your life at your level per time with joy. Every time you are contented in God, you are not complacent with your level, but you are rested in God. You need to learn this principle. Many people are not able to operate in faith because they are allowing the pressures of today and the things that they have not yet seen in their lives to dominate their lives much more. Hallelujah. So you find people start a business or are just starting in a career and they are not willing to gently, patiently wait for God to let things happen the way God wants it to happen. When you are truly having faith in God, certain things may not look like it around you right now. But the faith that you have in God will help you to live stressless. And that stressless lifestyle will continue to produce more for you. in the mighty name of Jesus. We need to come to the place where we do not let the things that the devil will want to challenge our faith come in between. Rest in God. He knows the best for you per time. And as you keep serving him, he will continue to perfect all that concerns you. In the name of Jesus. Those days, I remember I will put him on my neck and we will run to church. We will walk to church. The church was about a 25, 30 minute walk from where we lived at that time. And right very early in the morning, I would put him on my neck and we would walk. We didn't have a car. And we would walk cheerfully, joyfully. We would be singing songs, the new songs we were listening to and learning at that time. We would be singing them together. And at times he would ask me, he would say, "Dad, where is the car?" Because he remembers that we had a car when we were coming from. And I'll tell him, "The car is coming. The car is coming. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord." I share those things because at times it will look as if those stages in your life never happened. And when people see a few things around you, at times they think that that's how you've always been. And they'll say, but Brother Dave, why wouldn't it be easier for you to do these things? After all, you have this, you do that, you do this. It didn't start like that. Wherever you are today, find a way to serve God faithfully, stresslessly. Let God bless you and take you further, even as you are stressless in serving, in the mighty name of Jesus. Young children are very insistent. We read this from the story of blind Bartimaeus. I won't read it again. You know it from Mark chapter 10, verse 46 to 48. Young children, don't allow you to stop them. If they say, "I want ice cream," and you say no, they come back again and say, "I want ice cream." You say no, they come back the third time and say, "I want ice cream." Because they want that thing at that time. We as Christians must be persistent, always asking from God the things that we believe that are ours. Not being arrogant about it, but simply knowing fully well that when we trust God and we are persistent, like blind Bartimaeus, who did not allow the people to tell him to shut down and stop talking, but rather he kept on crying, "Son of David, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." We must be such people who do not allow the things of this world to intimidate us. Finally, I want to say, children are very spontaneous. This is a childlike attribute that we need to have in faith. Spontaneity simply means that they respond immediately. When you are a child of God and you want to walk in faith, you must learn how to be spontaneous. You must learn how to just move as God ordains. Many times, God's instructions are very, very gentle, but they come with a demand. You have to be sensitive. A lot of us are missing out on the things that we should be doing and the places that we ought to be going in life because we are not sensitive and we are not spontaneous enough. At times we don't hear God at all. We are too busy with so many other things of life, not allowing God to speak to us. And at times we hear God, but we don't respond as quickly as we ought to. When I was traveling to China some years back, this is 2012, I flew through Qatar, which is Doha Airport. That's the capital of Qatar Republic. And very lovely airport, very, very beautiful, well-designed, relaxing environment. And we sat there waiting for the flight from Doha to the place I was going in China. And God said something to me. He said, "Son, opportunities are like airplanes at an airport. You don't need all of them to get to where you are going, but you need to be on time to catch yours." You need to be on time. May you be on time. May you be on time. As you hear God, may you be on time. There is something about timing with God that is so important in the things of faith. Abraham knew it. Genesis chapter 12 from verse 1. Look at that. "Now the Lord said to Abraham, 'Get out of your country, from your family and your father's house, to a land I will show you.'" Go to verse 4. Go to verse 4. And the Bible says in verse 4, "So Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him." But the key thing is Abraham departed. God said, "Get out." Abraham departed. When God speaks to you and I, we must understand that we must come to the place of immediate departure. As long as God is saying it's time to depart, we must depart. Many of us have missed out on timings of various things in our lives simply because we are not spontaneous enough. When you tell children we're traveling or we're going somewhere, they just respond. Young children, it's when they grow up that they start to argue with you and ask, where are we going? How long is the trip? Are you sure we're coming back today? Because they are growing, they have become mature. But when they were young toddlers, when you say, children, we're going to London now, they say, yay! And they get on. You just dump them in the car. That's the truth. You just dump them there and you are gone. You are gone. But at the stage, you say, children, we're going to London now. They say, why? Because we need to go and do certain things that, you know, and they say, why again? So you answer about five or six whys before they move from where they are. And that's what we do as Christians too. When we are young children of God, God says, my son, I'm doing this in your life. Get on your knees now and pray and receive. Tomorrow you move. We do it immediately. But after some time, we're becoming mature. God said, my son, this is what I want to do in your life. We say, why? God said, because I want to take you to the next level so that you can fulfill destiny. Say, why? When we don't move in spontaneity, we don't allow our faith to be activated. Peter was a man who always was spontaneous too. He said, if it is you, Lord, bid me to come. And this is Matthew 14, 28 and 29. Jesus said, come. And when Peter came down, the Bible says he walked to go towards Jesus. May you always be spontaneous in your reactions. I say, may you always be spontaneous in your reactions of faith in the name of Jesus. We must have a desire for the sincere milk of the Word of God. It will make us grow. Whilst we need to be mature in handling the things of spiritual matters, we must know that there are limitations of maturity, and this must be laid aside constantly. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 is my last scripture. The Bible says, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking. Tell your neighbor for me, lay them aside. You don't need them. Say, you don't need malice. Are you talking to yourself or to your neighbor? Look at your neighbor and say, you don't need malice. You don't need deceit. You don't need hypocrisy. You don't need envy. You don't need any evil speaking. All you need is a desire for the sincere, the pure, the total milk of the Word of God so that you can grow. Hallelujah. May that continue to be your portion in the mighty name of Jesus. Friends, I want you to know that God has no problem in giving us faith and helping us to accomplish much more by faith. But we must come to the place where we are childlike in accepting the things that God has for us. We must understand that He wants us as a people to constantly look unto Him, constantly expect of Him. Children are very, very reliant on parents. We must be completely, totally dependent on God. Moses said, Lord, if you will not go with us, we will not go. Make it as simple as that. Lord, if you are not in it, I don't want it. I pray that prayer every day. I pray for this church to be filled with people. I pray for this church to fulfill destiny. But I also pray, Lord, anyone you don't intend for this assignment, let them not waste their time to come here and my own time as well. Let them quickly find where they should go in good time, so that we don't waste each other's time. Praise the Lord. It is very important because people are meant for different things, different times. So we pray that God will help us to be in a place of total dependence on God in the name of Jesus. God will not fail you. Amen. I say He will not fail you. Amen. As you depend on Him, He will continue to answer to your matters. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Please bow your heads with me and let us talk to God together.